Fridays are awe-inspiring. Not quite. Fridays are awe-warning. No, Fridays are awesome. Welcome to Friday, October 17th. I'm Carl Azus with your commercial-free newscast from CNN. Hurricane Gonzalo is churning in the North Atlantic Ocean. Yesterday, it grew to Category 4 strength on the Saffir-Simpson scale, which measures a hurricane's sustained wind speed. Category 4 brings winds of 130 to 156 miles per hour. It can cause catastrophic damage. Last night, forecasters predicted Gonzalo would brush by the island of Bermuda, but they weren't sure of its path, so a direct hit is possible. Bermuda's under a hurricane warning. Damaging winds, heavy rains, and flooding are expected. Gonzalo already hit the Virgin Islands Monday, but it was weaker then and caused mostly power outages and property damage.
But I can't foresee a case where we should reintroduce large ground combat forces into Iraq. But again, war is discovery. ISIL is a national security threat. If we get to that point, I'll make the recommendation.
General Martin Dempsey is the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. He's the top U.S. military advisor to the president. And he's talking about a controversial point in the U.S.-led war against ISIL, or ISIS, the Islamic State terrorist group. President Obama has repeatedly said no U.S. boots on the ground, meaning he won't send U.S. troops into direct contact with ISIS, though hundreds are in Iraq now advising and helping others fight ISIS. But several experts are saying U.S. troops may be what's needed to ultimately defeat the terrorists.
Massive explosions in northwestern Syria. Activists say these are tunnels full of explosives being detonated by militants as clashes broke out between regime and opposition forces. Just the latest in escalating violence across Syria and Iraq. Around the besieged city of Kobani on the Syria-Turkey border, 21 coalition airstrikes, the largest number of strikes since operations began, finally stepping up attacks against ISIS positions to protect the town. But the White House still cautioning airstrikes can only have so much impact in Kobani.
That impact is constrained by the fact that there aren't forces on the ground that can follow up on those airstrikes to end that siege.
Pentagon officials say don't expect a change in strategy. They long warned U.S. air power could only do so much.
I also want to emphasize that no one is under any illusions, that airstrikes alone will destroy ISIL.
Iraq's Anbar province, the western approach to Baghdad, may be running out of time. ISIS has surrounded and is preparing to attack Al-Assad Air Base, one of Iraq's largest, according to security sources. If they succeed, ISIS will have a new cache of weapons. It comes as General Martin Dempsey, chairman of the Joint Chiefs, holds the largest meeting of the coalition to date. 22 nations sending their military chiefs to Washington to review the war against ISIS. The U.S. has used Apache helicopters and AC-130 gunships at low altitude to virtually strafe ISIS forces. But ISIS continues to regroup and train for battle, raising the question once again, is there a solution?
It is looking more and more like Chairman Dempsey is going to have to go back to the president and ask the president to authorize the introduction of U.S. combat forces into Iraq.
Your teachers might remember today's date from 1989, especially if they lived in California at the time. The San Francisco Bay Area was violently jolted by its worst earthquake in more than 80 years. It hit just after 5 o'clock p.m. local time, before the start of Game 3 of the World Series. Those who were watching on TV just saw this. The Oakland A's and San Francisco Giants wouldn't actually play that game until 10 days later. A slip in the San Andreas Fault had shaken the ground. It lasted 15 seconds, its magnitude 6.9. It killed dozens of people, injured thousands, and damaged or destroyed property all over the region. That includes the San Francisco-Oakland Bay Bridge. Part of its top deck just collapsed. Building technology has improved since then, and it's a good thing.
October 17th, 1989. It's as if the entire Bay Area has been beaten. $10 billion in damages. It could have been so much worse.
I define a major big one as a $100 billion loss. We're expecting residential damage of 100,000 buildings, commercial building damages in the tens of thousands. You could be looking at deaths on the order of 1,800 to over 3,000.
The epicenter of the 1989 earthquake was 60 miles south of the bay and registered 6.9, 30 times less powerful than the 1906 quake centered inside San Francisco. It wasn't the big one. For just Northern California, seismologists say there's a more than 60% chance that there will be an earthquake of 6.7 or higher in the next 23 years.
The Hayward is really our biggest concern.
The Hayward Fault.
It sits geographically in the center of the region, and it's the most heavily populated. 2 million people sit directly on top of the Hayward Fault.
Stress from moving geological plates along faults cause earthquakes, and the Hayward is due for a big one.
The Hayward had an earthquake in 1868. It moves on average every 150 to 60 years.
In other words, it produces a big temblor about every century and a half. 1868 plus 150 is 2018.
We're basically right there. Now that's an average. It could wait 20, 30 years. It could happen tomorrow.
And because it could happen tomorrow, the Bay Area has been preparing since 1989.
We've done a lot. It really started the retrofitting going in this area.
Bridges have been retrofitted or replaced, utilities reinforced. There's now a San Francisco law requiring owners strengthen housing built on landfill with garages on the first floor. And San Francisco's high pressure water system is being upgraded.
Do I think we'll see the big one in the Bay Area in my lifetime? I hope not. I fear we will. And I hope it's 10, 20 years from now, because we will have accomplished a lot more.
We're starting in the south and working our way northwest to the far east. It'll all make sense. Hebron Middle School in Shepherdsville, Kentucky. Welcome to the roll. Good to see the Panthers watching today. Pendleton High School in Pendleton, Oregon. Hello to the Buckaroos. Awesome mascot. And across the Pacific to Tokyo, Japan, we're shouting out the American School in Japan. Great to see you. Soccer's fine with a soccer ball, but it's even awesomer with a bubble ball. Why? Because bubble ball. You just slip your upper body into a giant bubble with handles, and then you take a game with sessions, possessions, and divisions, and add the fun of collisions. Who said soccer wasn't a contact sport? Bubble ball is best played like bumper cars. Sure, you can drive the car or the ball, but the fun is in the bumps. In bubble ball, everyone catches air, everyone gets a rebound, and everyone has a ball. It's a great way to deflate an inflated ego without actually bursting anyone's bubble. Woo! I'm Carl Azus. Hope you're a round Monday when we bounce back your way. Have a great weekend.